Hello, I'm W.T. Edmonson, and welcome to Focus. Freedom often causes unbelievable silence. Of course, Focus is dedicated to educating and informing the public on issues of politics, social justice, and community. Today, our show is about community. Education is important. Everyone from parents to politicians say that it is important. The question is, what do you say? We do, other than simply say that education is important, but we do very little to make that a reality. Far too many parents do not take an active role in the education of their kids. Politicians use education in their stump speeches and as part of their platform to get elected, and then commence to cut education budgets once in office. Teachers have had to become more and more disciplinarians in the classroom and police in the classroom, attempting to ensure that the kids remain safe. Even on the playgrounds, teachers have to police the playgrounds. Teachers are spending their own money to provide supplies for their own classrooms. Yet, having done all of this, we see teachers in some places having to go to the streets to protest and fight for rights that they once thought were in place and could never be taken away from them. Students aren't entering the field of education as they once did. Why? Well, it's the money there. Education is not known to be one who pays the best salaries. But everyone from the politicians to physicians to doctors and lawyers and politicians and all will profess that education is the hallmark that made them what they are. But yet very little is done to ensure that that education is in fact granted to all. So what do? We have with us two great teachers, a mother and daughter team. Our guests are Ms. Sandra Allen, a retired school teacher from the Jefferson City Public School System, and her daughter, Ms. Rhonda Allen, a current teacher in the Jefferson City Public School System. Welcome to Focus.
Thank you.
Well, this is a program that I have thought about for some time and continue to put it off for one reason or the other. But as I saw just a few months ago, individuals going to the streets in various cities and states to protest the attack on unions and teachers' unions in particular, it led me to say that I could no longer put this off. So thank you for accepting our invitation. Well, since both of you are Allens, I hope that you will allow me to call you by your first names.
Most definitely.
Okay. Sandra, how many years did you teach?
I am very proud to say 37 years.
In the Jefferson City Public School System?
Well, I had a wonderful career. I taught first in the rural community, and then I moved to a parochial school here in Jefferson City, and then I finished up at public school.
Okay. Rhonda, how many years have you been teaching?
9 years.
9 years. You have a few years to catch up.
Yes.
Sandra, when and why did you first realize that you wanted to become a teacher?
You know, that's a good question. It seems like I've always known that I wanted to be a teacher. And oddly enough, right behind the station here is where I lived and went to school in, you know, what is no longer part of this building, but it was on this actual piece of land. before, and there was a huge incinerator out in the back, a big concrete burning area. And I would carefully watch the custodian at the end of every school year and watch all the wonderful things he dumped in, books and workbooks and broken crayons and papers and pencils and the old-fashioned mimeograph purple sheets. And I couldn't wait to get over into that to collect things so I could play school with my brothers and sisters. And there were six of us, so I had lots of students.
Yeah. What about you?
My story is a little more unique in that I really didn't think that I wanted to be a teacher in the beginning. I like to think of it like the characters in The Wizard of Oz who are out looking for something and all along they've already had it. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of how my story is. I originally majored in broadcast journalism and that didn't work out. And I was kind of thinking, oh, what should I be? What should I do? And I kept hearing this voice from her saying, why don't you try education? I think that's kind of what you were born to do. And so that's the route that I took, and it's exactly where I'm supposed to be.
Mm-hmm. After coming to it hesitantly, what finally attracted you to teaching?
Well, I've always been a very creative person, and I like paper and markers and pencils and anything having to do with writing. And so as a child, I would always write and do things. And of course, I saw her grading papers and doing all kinds of projects. And so that's what attracted me most to the profession. And then, of course, as I got a little bit older, how she really touched the lives of other people. Because whenever we'd be out, she'd see past students of hers and how they'd light up when they'd see her and how she could remember everybody's name. So that's what attracted me to the profession the most.
What was it about teaching that attracted you other than seeing all those things being thrown away?
Well, first of all, I think it was the idea that teaching looked like fun. Basically, every teacher I had looked like he or she absolutely enjoyed what they were doing. And I kept thinking, I want to be a part of that. So I started to observe these people and just really just kind of make mental notes of what it was they did and how they did it and why it seemed so joyful to them. And I kept thinking, that is what I want to do.
Hmm. Rhonda, during your education career before you decided to venture into education, was there any points where you saw a teacher up in front of the classroom teaching and something in the back of your mind said, you know, maybe I want to do that?
Well, I will tell you, one of my favorite teachers, Dr. Miller, was a seventh grade English teacher of mine, and he really brought everything alive for me. I loved that man, and he just seemed like he just loved everything he did, and every project he gave us was so unique, and he went above and beyond, and so maybe in the back of my head, I was kind of thinking, you know, kind of a little voice telling me, this is where you should be going. But definitely, his teaching really kind of sparked an interest in me, for sure.
Mm-hmm. Now, you indicated earlier that you saw your mom grading papers and so forth growing up and meeting people. As you observed that, what did that say to you?
It said to me that, first of all, that she was a definitely hard worker and this job was not something easy for sure as far as the workload. But as far as going out and meeting people in the community, that she really did make a difference in these people's lives, you know. And so many people even today, you know, 20, 25 years later say, you know, you were my favorite teacher, you really made a difference in my life. And what's more rewarding than that? You know, somebody being able to say, you made a difference in my life, so.
Mm. What about you, Sandy?
I would say basically the same thing. And I don't really even know how it happened unless, I mean, I consider it just a gift from God, that these children have always been so important to me that I tried to learn everything I could about them when I had them. And it was a big thing for me every morning to stand by the door and look at them and see what was different. Did they have a new haircut? Did they have new glasses? Did they look happy? Did they look sad? And I figured if I could jump right in on that before they entered the room, that maybe we could have a good day. Mm-hmm. Maybe I could give a positive about, oh, you look so handsome mm-hmm. in those new glasses, or oh, I love your hair, whatever. And just like Rhonda said, when you take that kind of interest, I think, in a child, you kind of remember things about them, their names, and then later on, you just get all these wonderful, wonderful rewards of your teaching. You get neat notes or Christmas cards or pictures. I've even gotten letters that tell me all these things, and I don't know who the letter's from until mm-hmm. the end of the letter. And it's a former student, like she said, that I had years and years ago. Mm-hmm. So it's definitely been a joy.
I have a problem remembering names. is there a technique, or is that something that just comes natural to you, to year after year learn all these young people's names?
Well, for me, it kind of goes back with what she says. If you're really building a relationship with every student, and you know about their families and their lives and what's important to them and what they love to do, it's not really that hard to remember names. And of course, some children you remember more than others. But definitely, and that you can still see that little face, and think, I remember when you did this, or do you still love to sing, or still love to do artwork? So I think that's the thing. We make connections with our students so that, when you see that face, you can say, oh yeah, I remember you had a little brother named so-and-so. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's almost automatic. It's like my brain doesn't really remember, but when I start talking to you, poof, mm-hmm. this name comes out, and it's like, whoa.
Yeah.
And of course, to see a child's face beam, when you're able to call their name that many years after the fact.
Well, I've tried all kind of techniques. It's just not something that I'm gifted with. let's go back a step. What factors do you think distinguishes a good teacher from an average teacher?
Okay. I would say
we're not calling names, so you got it.
I'm thinking, in my opinion, a good teacher is one who takes the time to build rapport with their students and their parents. One who goes above and beyond the curriculum and what they're expected to do. One who also is active in the community, because to us it was always important that if we say we care about you in the classroom, we felt like we needed to show that in the community, that you don't just see me behind the walls of the school, that I'm out there in the community also doing things, hopefully, mm-hmm. that will enrich your life. I think good teachers also step out of a situation and examine it, is it the child, is it me? And then they do research, they read, they inquire, they talk to other people who are knowledgeable, and they try to find ways to reach a child, no matter what the situation is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Rhonda, I've observed you over the past few years. You not only seem to teach the subject matter, but you appear to also teach and train kids in the performing arts, memorization and voice projection, delivery, stage presence. Why is that important to you?
Well, first let me say that the performing arts is such a big part of my life. I think that, I grew up in J band playing an instrument. I sang. I was on the stage a lot through high school and through college. And so I feel like those things really helped shape me who I am to be today. They taught me discipline and, you know, just being able to drop the stage fright and be able to get up in front of someone. And so, you know, my brother and I grew up having to do things, especially like in church or in different areas where we'd have to get up and say something. And a lot of times kids today don't get those opportunities. So I feel like bringing something that I love to them teaches them not only to be able to get up and do that, but just it teaches them how to make eye contact. It is a discipline too. You know, you've got to practice and memorize something. And not only that, it makes you feel good. And then also, you know, I could be shaping somebody who might be on a stage one day. You know, not everybody's going to grow up to be a doctor or a lawyer. I could be shaping somebody to become a performer. And so that's why I do it. And it's fun.
Well, you do a fantastic job.
Thank you.
We're about to wrap it up here. Sandra, one closing statement I would like from you. What are some of the notable changes that you have observed in the teaching profession or in the system in general, from the time you came into the system to the time you left? Any changes that you observed that cause for contemplation as to where are we really going?
Okay. I would say, and I've kind of always thought this way, that kids are kids, and it doesn't matter if they're in parochial school or public school or homeschooled, whatever. They basically are the same way. They experience many of the same things. Unfortunately, our society has changed so much from when I grew up, and our poor kids are just kind of caught up in all of that. They see and hear so many things that impact them. The things they have to worry about. I often step back and think, when I was a child in school, we had fire drills. And that was basically it. Now we have to have not only fire drills, but earthquake drills, armed intruder drills. And of course, we don't call them that, but that's what they are. We just call them evacuation drills. But children have so many things that I'm sure they think of and worry about, and things that impact them. You know, just trying to have some self-esteem. A lot of times, good children get off on the wrong foot because they're trying to have that self-esteem with their peers, so they may act out in particular ways when they're basically really good kids. It's just they're trying to survive. And you know, even the bullying existed, of course, even when I was in school. I don't know if it was quite as vicious as it seems to be in some aspects now. But again, you know, there's the internet and just all of these things that have changed and are going on so quickly to impact our children. Mm-hmm. But I don't want to put this plug in if I could. That's why it's really important to Rhonda and to me for parents to give their children as many positive experiences as they can. I mean, we have all kinds of free opportunities in this community. Take them out so that, one, you're spending time with them. Two, they're seeing and learning about different people and diversity. Also, hopefully parents will work closely with their teachers. And, you know, yes, ask questions, but trust those teachers. Just like the two of us, we sincerely love the children we teach and have taught as, you know, to a certain degree as much as the parents have, because when they're successful, we share that joy of their success. Also, when you mention the politicians, I invite politicians to please come away from their desk in the Capitol or wherever else and step into these schools, see what's going on, get to know teachers on an individual basis. It's so important. We can't really judge what we've never seen or experienced.
Rhonda, could you tell me this? We were talking about observations of changes that has taken place in the public school system. You've been in the system 9 years. Mm-hmm. What have you observed between your first experience in the system and now?
I think technology has really just taken off. Just 9 years ago when I started, you know, people had cell phones, but you didn't really hear children having cell phones. Now I'm competing with everybody having a cell phone in the classroom. Everybody knows about the internet and Facebook and Twitter and, you know, social media type things. So that's one of the biggest things that I feel like is a huge difference. And so I feel like as a teacher, I have to go where they are. And so if that is what is going on today and what people are doing and what the children are doing, then that's how I present my lessons. You know, a lot of times, you know, we have a big smart board in the classroom, so I use a smart board. I go on YouTube a lot to show different examples of things. So I have to go where they are. A lot of today's children are being entertained, you know, by television and internet and cell phones. And so if I have to entertain them, you know, by showing them what they need to know, then so be it.
How do you go about getting the most out of a student? You have 20 students in your classroom, individual personalities, coming from different situations in their homes and so forth. How do you go about individually addressing each individual student's need and their learning style?
I bet we're thinking, thinking the same word. Rapport is a great part of it. I have seen over my years children who test-wise are said only to have this much potential. But when that child and I have a good thing going, they exceed that potential because they want to please me. They want to give me everything and more they have to offer. And when you take that kind of time to build that rapport with a child, you discover all kinds of little things about them, things that turn them on and things that make them happy. And then another thing that Rhonda and I often talk about is team building. You know, we work really hard, she does now and I did in the past, to make our classes cohesive so that children, one, if they're busy learning to like each other and get to know each other, you don't have nearly the problem with bullying or put downs or whatever. And that seems so important because then you're working for a common goal. I mean, just like raising money for the tornado victims, food for the Samaritan Center, whatever. When there's some kind of common good, those children unite and, oh, it is wonderful to see them at their best.
Anything
else? Yes, just to piggyback on that with the rapport thing, I think once they have rapport built with you, then they understand that, you know that they can do it, you know, and you have to really make them believe that they can achieve anything that they want to and that you believe in them and you're never going to give up on them, no matter how hard or difficult that it is. And so every single year I have several success stories of children that come. And, you know, they're not maybe as good of a student as they ever thought that they could be. And so by the end of the year, it's just so rewarding to be able to see that this child has really worked hard to do great things. And so I think that comes from having such good rapport with them. We always say we're a family. And that's really how it functions, just like a family would function.
Can I add one other thing that I know she does well, and we did it to a certain degree. I don't think we actually called it what she does, but they had meetings, class meetings, where the children got to have input into, we have this situation and we need to resolve it. What do you think? And you know what? That gives kids ownership, too, in that mm-hmm. classroom that is just incredible. And mm-hmm. they really feel closer and a part of that room. It is their classroom.
We hear more and more talk about teacher performance. What do you think is the better teaching performance tool? And what should be done with teachers who continuously fail to meet those performance standards? Politicians say, let's fire them. What do you say?
Well, first, as far as, you know, what we are responsible for, I do really believe that we need to be held accountable for what it is that we're supposed to be doing, whether that's through a standardized test. I'm not totally sure about that, but I do feel like we do need to be held accountable because, let's face it, you know, we are holding these children's future in our hands. I do feel like the pressure has gotten so intense that, you know, children are stressed out, teachers are stressed out because, you know, we've kind of gotten away from what education is really about, you know. We feel like, and I think I can speak for her, that, you know, we are trying to mold children into becoming productive citizens into the community and being able to hold a job, whatever job that may be. And so that doesn't necessarily mean that because you scored proficient or advanced that you're going to be a productive citizen in the community. So I feel like we do need to be held accountable as far as being able to show what we're doing in the classroom. And for the teachers that aren't showing that, I think before you can just say, let's fire them, set up a mentoring program, you know, get someone maybe in there to help them so that, you know, you can really see what's going on before you just say, you know, you're fired. Mm-hmm.
See, I would totally agree with that. And I would say observation. You know, you can't really make a judgment call on what's going on in a classroom or with a teacher if you're not in there to see. And if you come in, and don't just come once, don't just come and stay for 10 minutes, make arrangements to come and spend some time, donate some of your time and energy in the school system, whether you have a child or a grandchild or whatever there or not. It's just a good place to be so that you can see. Of course, we always hear way too many of the terrible things that go on in schools, but there are probably many, many, many more good things that don't get covered. And once you're there, you'll probably catch the same bug we did and learn to love education. But it's so important to observe teachers, to have a mentoring program, and maybe a longer period of time for mentoring, not just for a first-year teacher. Many of the experiences I've had with mentoring, you and that person you're mentoring become good friends. And so throughout the years, you touch bases with each other just to see how things are going or what new ideas you have or, you know, successes, failures you've had, all of that. Mm. But mentoring is a big part of it.
Mm. I've heard that boys and girls learn differently and they mature differently at different stages. Is there a difference in the way that you educate boys versus girls?
I'm going to let you answer first.
Well, I do think that there is a little bit of a difference, yes. You know, boys, you know, just statistically saying, you know, supposedly mature later than girls. And I really think, though, that, you know, if the teacher is doing what they're supposed to do and they're there for, you know, all the children, that there really, to me, doesn't make that much difference between boys and girls. I do feel like we're in a society now where we do need to push for more females to get into math and science, you know, so we can get them out there into the workforce more in the math and science area. But for me, no. They're
okay.
Kids.
See, I wanted to hear that younger end. Because basically, I think the same way. Mm-hmm. There might be some small, small differences. But basically, like she said, if the teacher is working with each individual child in what they need, I don't really see a big to-do. Now, grant you with reading, and you couldn't really blame the boy. Some of the stories that I know that I've had to use in the past or they've grown up with might not have been very exciting. But, you know, if you can get things that boys enjoy, reading, adventure and motorcycles and race cars. Of course, we have some girls that like that too, but a little difference there.
You have a closing comment here. As a retired teacher, what can you freely share about the educational system or process that you might have been a little reluctant to speak on when you were in the system?
Okay, that's a good question. And hopefully anything I felt back when I was employed in the schools, I said, because it would have been for the betterment of all the children and for our systems. But I would say that, and I've already said basically, politicians need to come into our schools. They're making way too many policies that affect our schools that are not necessarily good for children. And many of them have not come to visit schools to see what's going on. So I would invite them, you know, check, see if you can't come to a school to visit. Schools generally are open to visitors to come in. And I'd love to see parents and students and teachers work even better together. Because when a child knows that, my teacher and my parents are staying in touch, my mom, my dad are coming to school, they're going to see what I'm doing, they're going to see my work, it can't help. I mean, couldn't do anything but help a child to be more productive in school.
Okay. Well, thank you all very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Tremendous information. Hopefully something that you've said today will encourage others to go into education.
We hope so.
Okay. I hope so.
Thank you for tuning in. We'll see you next time. God bless.